Right. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Ministry Revealed. It is February 8th, 2018. And today I've got some more exciting passages for you. And I've got another confirmation. It is not biblical, but everybody knows who this guy is. Excuse me. And I'm going to back some of his stuff with scriptures. For me, when I read his stuff, it's... And I don't usually. This is the first time in forever. I've never even read this one before until this morning. Actually, last night. And I caught something in it this morning that I just went, you know, I shouldn't be surprised anymore. My confirmation of the 14 years and how I explain 10 and a half years from Psalm 90 and 10, which is Revelation 12, you know, that time to when they fly away into the wilderness. You know, being 10, I say it's more what it's going to be. It's going to be within the 10-year time frame, more like 10 and a half years. And then it's time, times, and half a time, confirmed from Daniel as well. That's when they fly away, showing you guys that it's the 14 years of tribulation. Well, let me show you from somewhere else that nobody's ever mentioned before. But we're going to cover a few things today, kind of just touching on some things, maybe finishing up some thoughts on a previous video or two. For example, look at this one here. Remember we were talking about, I was talking in one of the videos, and by the way, before I get in, hopefully everybody's having a good time, a good week. We are under snow up here in Calgary. We're probably coming up close to a foot and a half of snow, but it's nice and light and fluffy. And I've got a 14-year-old son, almost 15, so I don't even have to shovel. Isn't that exciting? I love it. I always tell him that's what I had him for, so stop complaining. So, anyways, okay, let me get into this here. So, we had touched on this. This is just going to be brief here. I had touched on this system that's coming, or sorry, not the system, but the galaxy that's coming in. Oh, you know what I should do while we're waiting here? I'm going to show you this, okay? This Messier 87 is what I was talking about before, that for the first time in human history, they're expecting to see the event horizon, right? It was a couple of three videos ago, the event horizon of a black hole. And this is where they're going to see it. They're going to see it in what they call M87 or Messier 87. Okay, and I want to do something for you guys here too. I want to show you guys something just that's really interesting. We know from Revelation 12, right? And again, I'm not saying that this is it. You know, it's called the event horizon. It's this spring, March or April. If it's the thing, I'm thinking it's going to be in March. All right, so they're saying March, April. I think even May might be a possibility, they said. But it's one of those three, and if this is the event that's coming, we're looking, I would say, for this being at March. So I'm not saying this is the event, but there are some really interesting quote-unquote coincidences. We know from Revelation 12, you know, the sun, the moon, the stars, you know, the woman. Well, we know that the only place in heaven where there's the woman is Virgo, right? Well, guess what constellation M87 is in? You guessed it, Virgo. Right? Is it right? Is it between the legs or anything like that in the gestation period that all of this stuff about September 23rd was? No. But let's have a look at it. Watch this. It's really wild. Turn the atmosphere off. Let's turn all these signs and symbols on. Let's go to a date and time. And then watch this. Okay, let me see. Oh, here she is. Okay, here's Virgo. Alright? And it's right up in here, or somewhere up in here, but it is in the constellation Virgo, right? All of this stuff here is Virgo. Oh, by the way, if you do a little study, this is quite interesting too. We know the bear, right? The big bear. This is Russia. There's the lynx, or the leopard, there's your Germany, and then there's Leo, the lion, which is Britain, right? over in Europe. And what's in the middle? The little lion. Right? False prophet. Think of that. These guys are all together, right? Anyways, wasn't where I was going. So, let's go see where Messier is. It's not the easiest thing to go in and find. Well, not that it's that difficult. But if you don't zoom in enough, you're in clicking on all sorts of these little things, trying to find out which is which, you know, where is it? And you got to zoom, zoom, zoom. And I thought this was interesting here, how they did this to this section. I don't know why they did it, but it's like almost like a real view of the galaxies out there. I see there's galaxies here. This is M86. See that? See, so there's M86 and M84 and there's M85 and there's all of these galaxies, okay? And they're all throughout here. Now we got to remember this event, this thing that's coming with the M87 could have been anywhere. It could have been any one of the numbers, right? 86, 85, whatever the case may be. And by the way, see how this square? I just find that interesting that it's only here. I wasn't able to find it anywhere else. Not that I spent a lot of time, but I couldn't find it anywhere else. And yet, this is the area. It's not in here, but it's the area that they're going to be looking at. So again, are they hiding something? Are they doing something? I don't know, right? But again, back to this number, 87. I showed you 86 and 84, and there's 85, and there, all the numbers for the M's are there. Yet, it's 87. Here is 87 right here, okay? Are you ready? Watch what it's called. And now, this is Stellarium. This is a scientific program, and it's these people, not Stellarium, but it's that community of astronomers and so forth that name this stuff. All right? Are you ready for the name of M87? See, it's in Virgo. It's the M87 galaxy. See, it's a galaxy. It's a massive, massive galaxy if you read up on it. And there's going to be a black hole. They already know there's a black hole, but they're expecting to see the event horizon of a black hole never before seen in human history. And they're lining up all major satellites around the world to focus in right here in Jupiter to be able to see this event horizon of the black hole, which has to do with light. And look what it's called. It's called a smoking gun. What? I just thought again, you know, how is it these kind of things line up and they're pointing and they're showing us this and that, and you know, it's just bizarre. In Virgo, dealing with light, what does a black hole do? It sucks in all light, right? And it's in a galaxy, the largest galaxy in the, like, a massive, I don't know if it's the largest one, but so big, like they're just in awe of how big it is, and they've been watching it for years. And this galaxy called M87 is called, in Virgo A, is called Smoking Gun. I don't know about you guys. I just find that really interesting. All right? Virgo Smoking Gun. Now watch this. I didn't do a search on Messi. I should have. But the number 87, right? That number seems pretty significant to us. You know, we're in the year 5778 is about to begin and would have just begun if this happens here in March. And it's 87, which is backwards. We find that all the time, right? If you want to understand a lot of these scriptures from beginning to end, from Genesis to Revelation, you know, it's always like that. There's always stuff backwards, right, that's revealing stuff to us. Well, how about what the number 87 means biblically? Check this out. 87, the number means everlasting Father. 87 means everlasting Father. See? 87, the everlasting Father. I am the Lord. We can't make this stuff up, right? I mean, it's crazy. So, I'm still not saying this is the event. We don't really know. Well, when it happens, whatever the event's going to be, we will know. But right now, we don't exactly know, but we do know we should be looking in Virgo, and this is in Virgo. And what do you think's going to happen when they see it and this event horizon is going to be known? Do you think it's going to be on every single TV station in the world? Pretty much. It's going to be a massive deal, a really big deal. And what a better time than for the everlasting Father, right, through the Spirit, to come and take the bride. I think that's awesome. So let's see what else we got here. This is another piece I was talking about. I was looking at, because of a guy's video yesterday, it got me looking into some stuff with Nostradamus. I'm not going to leave the link, but you can see it up here. Catholic-saints.net/Nostradamus/. And it has his previous ones and what he's called and how they've been accurate. Well, you can read in here. And I mean, I read this and you can see where everything lines up. Look at this. The rain of stones. That's pretty straightforward, isn't it? I've showed you guys. That's Revelation 6. That's the easy one, right? You can go on. You could read it. There's so many things. But there's, in particular, there's something I wanted to touch on in here. Fire in this from the skies. This Mobus, I'm not sure who that is. Some people say maybe Antichrist and so forth, right? Again, look at, you see things like, during the appearance of the bearded star. There's another one up here with, during the time the hairy star appears, right? This is when the red dragon appears, right? You're going to get, by the time Revelation comes and it starts raining on the earth in, not Revelation, right away, but by Revelation 6, right? The cast her early figs. That's what that is talking about right there. And it goes in. You guys can read this for yourselves, okay? The great mountain. When I was reading this, it's almost like I felt like he was just reading the book of Revelation and the timeline and stuff in tribulation and then was saying it in his cryptic ways. But obviously when you see things where he says, you know, within this time frame or that time frame, you know something's been revealed to him. And I'm going to prove to you, well, you know, people will say, well, this is just Nostradamus. I've been telling you guys this for a few months now about the 14 years. All right? I've backed it so much. My last video, I don't know about you guys. I shouldn't apologize. I was so excited in that last video. You know, it's just so incredible. Well, you're going to see somebody else who backs what I was saying. And so many people have read this guy, and yet nobody has caught it because nobody understood it. He tells us 14 years, straight out, not in mysterious words. He tells us 14 years, okay? I'll show you. But look at this. The great mountain, 1 mile in circumference, after peace, war, famine, and flooding. So after peace, war, flooding, famine, flooding, it will spread far, drowning antiquities and their mighty foundations. Well, if we go into Revelation, watch this. Let's go into Revelation. Which one do I want to go into here? Give me a second. Let's go into Revelation 8 and look at where we see a great mountain. The second trumpet. See, the second trumpet's a great mountain. The third trumpet is a great star. This is a great mountain burning with fire cast into the sea. Right? That's where you have a great mountain, right? Burning with fire. It doesn't say burning with fire here, but burning with fire that's being cast, and it's going to spread far. And what happens? Drowning, but antiquities and their mighty foundations. What does that mean, antiquities and their mighty foundations? Watch this. Just, you know, I spend so many hours, and sometimes I watch videos, like I said, and boom, something catches me in a video, and I'm gone for the day. Hours just digging through and wherever the Spirit leads me. Watch this. Revelation 17. Watch this. This is a huge study here. Just the wondered and admired and marvel and the timing. It's really incredible. But watch this. And there are seven kings five are fallen. So when John is seeing this, they're already gone, right? It's not something in the end times where there were five that were still there, or the seven and they were still there. No, five of these kings are fallen, right? One is, and one is yet to come. And when he comes, he's going to be there for a short space, and then it goes on, okay? We're not going into that. Okay, but five are fallen, one is, and one is yet to come. And then I showed you what? Where he says, after this great mountain lands, right? And when did it come? When does this great mountain come? We know from Revelation... In Revelation 8, this is the beginning, right? Here's the end of seals right here. That time of... This time on earth, this about the space of half an hour, I believe is the about 6 months. And by the way, you know, there's the timeline. You guys can get it. I think, or not I think, it'll be in the comments in this video, the link, so you can go to the Google Drive, and it'll be there for you guys to print off and review. I was planning on going through it today and doing a breakdown for you guys, but I just got so caught off doing the searching and these other things that I'll come back to it maybe tomorrow or the next day. I'll do a video for it. So Friday or Saturday, I'll do a video on this and go through it with you guys, kind of in an overview, not going too deep, because that'll be in other videos when I'll spend the time in the seals, then I'll spend the time in the trumpets, and you know, spend time in the four horsemen, right? So we'll spend time in that. So it'll be in the comments, but I'll also have it in the about. So you can go into the about where Ministry Revealed stuff is and click on that link, and it should be posted there as well, okay? But here we are. We are that about half hour in heaven. This is when the rapture has already happened. 144,000 were sealed. The rapture has taken place after the sixth trumpet. After the sixth seal, and the church is now in heaven, okay? They're in heaven being shown around. This is what's going to take place. And then you now have the trumpets about to be let loose, okay? So you've had your half hour of silence. That's peace. That's the peace that's going to come. That's going to last 6 months after the sixth trumpet, after the rapture, okay? That's what he's saying here. After the peace. See, after the peace, after the war, where's the war? I showed you, it's just like Matthew, Mark, and Luke, right? Luke is to the bride, she's going to be gone, and we're going to talk about that today. More scriptural backing of the bride going. And then we have Mark that speaks to the church that's going to go through tribulation, church/Israel, right? And then we've got Judah, who Matthew is speaking to, who's going to be, that's talking through the whole thing in for trumpets, okay? Well, where do we have war? Well, we have war, famine, and flooding, right? After the peace. So what it's saying here is this mountain's going to fall, but it's going to come after the peace, seventh seal, after the flooding, after the famine, and after the war. All right, well, let's confirm where that is, right? We can go right into Revelation 6, right? Red Rider. War, black, famine, right? All this stuff is there. Now, you want to confirm, remember what I said, Mark is speaking to the church during the time of tribulation. When you go into the discourse, watch the Olivet Discourse. Got to remember, all three of them speak differently because of who they're speaking to. That's why you'll notice these changes in the discourse, the way they're spoken, because they are speaking to three different groups of people in how they're being spoken, how they're being presented. Watch this. We've covered this before, right? Earthquakes in diverse places. We know there's your famines. And what? Troubles. Because Mark's group, the churches, there's going to be a water event before they get raptured. Look, troubles doesn't just mean tribulation in this case. This is a different word for troubles. It means a disturbance that is of water. All right? So here we have Nostradamus that spoke about the second trumpet, and it's going to come after peace, which is the seventh seal, and after war, the Red Rider, famine, the Black Rider, and all of this stuff, which is also confirmed here, excuse me, in Mark, and after flooding. You see that? Nostradamus didn't seem to be a fool, you know what I mean? He's got some predictions here, and I'm able to see these end ones. And it says, it will spread far, drowning antiquities and their mighty foundations. Well, remember what else we just covered. All right, let's go back to Revelation 17. Watch this. You know how I get led to this stuff? I don't know except the Spirit, right? I don't know how to explain it. It just happens, right? It's just where I get led. Watch this. And there are seven kings, right? Five are fallen, already fallen, right? Even at the time when John's getting this revelation, they're already fallen. One is, and one is yet to come. Okay, watch this. One is, and one is yet to come. Seven hills of Rome. Rome is the first one to have been called and set up as seven hills. The other ones after Rome were copycats, right? You had even Newton, Massachusetts, and Constantinople that were copied after the example of what Rome did. All right, if you read through this, again, you can go up into here, into Wikipedia, Seven Hills of Rome, and you could see what had happened was there was like a moat, there was water through it. They drained it all out. They put up a fence, they walled it all, and protected themselves, okay? So what happens? There was a king. There was someone for each area, all right? They were over each area. But what happens? What about today? Where are we today, right? You want to see where we are today? Of the seven hills of current Rome, five, didn't we just read that? Are populated with, not people, with monuments, buildings, and parks. No more kings, right? Nobody's ruling them over anymore. So five of them, there's no more kings. Well, what about the sixth? Oh, here we go. Capitoline Hill now hosts what? Rome's City Hall. Can you say where the kings are, where the leaders are? Right here. They're in this one. These guys over here are empty. These are, you know, they're no more leaders over them. Nobody over them anymore, right? Just this one here is where the Capitol buildings and so forth are, all right? Which means what? There's your sixth. Well, what about your seventh? And the Palatine Hill, belongs to the main archaeological area. This one here. So these guys are just kind of, you know, nothing really going on here anymore. This one is, and this one is still counted separate as if to come. Right? Now, why do I say that? Well, check this out. Could there be something here in the end days, Antichrist related or false prophet related? Here's why I say that. This final area that's spoken about separately, these five are gone. This one is, and this one is ending at the end, spoken of separately. Watch this. It's called the archaeological area. What do you have in an archaeological area? Antiques? Antiquities from a time past, right? From archaeological digs? You get it? And what does he say? When this one comes, when this great mountain comes, right? What is it coming to do? It's going to hit and it's going to drown antiquities and their mighty foundations. Can you say, and mighty foundations? Rome will be destroyed. This is where that last guy is going to come from. Probably, is it false prophet or antichrist? I'm not sure. One is yet to come. Five are gone. And their foundations, because they're on mountains, they're on hills, right? That's their mighty foundation. And the last one is called the archaeological area. This is some deep information. I pray it doesn't apply to me like most of the stuff that I teach. or to my family, or to my viewers for that matter. Eventually, I believe, obviously, that's why the Lord's having me do it. It will, for those that are going to be in those days, to pay attention. But, I mean, you guys are going to be struggling for your lives, right? So I pray for me and my family and for you guys listening that you are going to be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come upon the whole earth, all right? And to stand before the Son of Man. That's Luke. That's Luke's group is to the bride, all right? And I'm going to show you more of that. So I just thought this was really cool. You know, there it was in Revelation 13, right? Right there, or sorry, Revelation 17, 10. There it is. Boom. So, and if you look at the timing of it too, right, when that other one comes, it's going to continue a short space, and then you have the beast that was and is not. Why do you think this is? Because he's going to be here during the time of the 42 months, during the part of seals. Then he's going to be away because his 42 months to continue is going to be gone, right? To continue. Then he's going to be gone, and then he's going to be again, and he's going to go into perdition. This is going to have to do when Satan, right, when he rises from the earth, when he's cast down to the earth, I should say, right? The key, they've unlocked the pit, so on and so forth. This isn't what I want to get into, but I was doing a whole bunch of studying on this today. But that's the who was, is not, and is, right? Because during the time of tribulation, you got to understand, this is all speaking during the 14 years of tribulation, which means somebody, Antichrist or false prophet, was here that this is relating to. Then he's going to be gone away for a while, and then he's going to come back again, and then he's going to be the embodiment of Satan. See, it's something that really bothers me, but I was talking to my wife about it last night or the night before, and I shouldn't let it bother me too much, but I have a tough time because when you watch some of these passages, and I understand that they don't know what I've been revealed and what I teach you guys about the 14 years, but the end times understanding without 14 years, it's impossible to understand. You cannot know, which is why we've been confused in the churches for so long for the way they've been teaching us. For anybody that spends time in scriptures trying and learning end times and trying to understand it, if you've been doing it from a 7-year point of view, which 99.99% of the world has been doing, because that's the way we've been taught, you'll never figure it out. That's why it's so confusing from Daniel and right into the book of Revelation. You have to understand it's 14 years. And then you can understand was, is not, and will be again, 42 months, 1260 gone, back again, time times and half the time, Judah flees. See that? There's 10 and a half years right there. It's not from the beginning. That's from mid-seals to the end, okay? So, but yeah, this is a whole other story. I didn't want to go down that little rabbit trail there. So I just thought, wow, Revelation 17, in a Wikipedia explanation of the seven hills of Rome, tells us exactly what Revelation 17 shows us, defines Revelation 17, 18, I think it is. Very interesting. But now let's go a little bit further. Let's see what else Nostradamus has to say. It shall be a time against the church, greater persecution than ever was. Against the church? Maybe you see where I'm going right away from my regular subscribers. Shall there be against the church a greater persecution than ever was? Well, wait a second. Doesn't the church teach you guys that the church isn't going through the tribulation? See what I'm saying? The church is going through the tribulation. The church gets raptured after the sixth seal, right? There are those within the churches, within the church, that are the bride, those who are ready. Those who are watching, those who are praying, those who are repenting, giving thanks to the Lord, spending time with them. Those are the bride. And they are within all the churches. But when the time comes, they're going to be gone before it all begins. And the time against the church of great persecution as never was before is going to begin. All right? There it is. He knows what he's talking about. Right, maybe that's why it wasn't very liked by the church. So, and then great epidemics, right? Then two-thirds of the world shall perish. You know, we see that going through into the trumpets as well. And in those days, desolation of the largest cities. You guys should read this. Will be depopulated in the largest cities. And he who would return shall be struck by the wrath of God. Right? So this is when it gets a little bit later in. And the sacred places shall be turned into stable for cattle, large and small, and put to profane uses. Right? You got to remember, this is at the point when he's talking wrath of God. This is now into bulls here. So when you read this part here, he's talking about, or maybe not even bulls, you know, late trumpets, right before the bulls and the wrath of God starts. But the wrath of God will be after that. And what do you see here? Large and small, profane use. Imagine what they're doing if it's saying profane use, right? You got to remember who's going to be here. It's going to be the fallen angels. It's going to be the deception. It's going to be absolute craziness, okay? But then keep reading. Watch this one. This one is what I want to share with you guys right here. This one here. Listen to this. More somebody else that backs what the Spirit's revealed to me that most of you guys know, Nostradamus, right? And during the said astrological computations, all right? So what he's saying is during these said times up here that I'm telling you about, right? These astrological calculations that I'm showing you, how did he do these calculations? Well, a lot of it was because he understood the sun, the moon, and the stars, right? Just like Genesis 1:14 tells us. That's what he put them up there for. That's God's time clock. Everything is there for us to understand. We just don't understand them anymore because we don't spend time looking up there, all right? So that's what he's saying. During the said astrological calculations, in harmony with the Holy Writ, the Holy Spirit, the persecution against the clergy, okay? The persecution against the clergy, which is the church, and we got to remember, it's still going to continue into the trumpets, shall have its beginning in the power of the north united with the east. Watch this. Look at that. Read that. And it shall last 11 years or a little less. Do you know where you've heard that before? From me. When I tell you it 10 and a half years. You know where 10 and a half years is when I tell you this? It's right here. This is your 10 and a half years. Tribulation is going to begin. Bride is gone. The escape of the bride, not the rapture, the escape of the bride, she's gone. Tribulation begins. And from the beginning of tribulation, from the first seal, all the way through this, Satan is cast out. What does he do? Satan is cast out. When he gets here, he realizes his time is short. He goes after the woman, and what? And the woman were given wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness, and she's going to be gone for how long? Exactly like Daniel is told. How long before this will end? It will be for a time, times, and half a time. To this point here, when she flees into the wilderness, when Satan arrives at the fifth trumpet, from this point on, there's 3.5 years. The time, times, and half a time. But from the beginning of the seals to this point after the fourth trumpet is 10.5 years. Revelation 12 is 10.5 years. 11, like Nostradamus just said, or a little less. These aren't my words. These are Nostradamus's words. I've been telling you guys that for a few months now, since it's been revealed to me, right? We can go back. One of the other ones I like to prove it on, which I know you guys know. I've shown it before more than once. Psalm 90 and 10, right? This is the exciting part. The days of your years are 70. There's 70. We are in the 70th since Israel came back. And it's coming to an end. We are weeks away. And there's going to be a 40-day sign. And we're how far away? We're 42 days away from the new year. Okay? So we're 42 days away from the new year before it goes to 71. See what I'm saying? The days of your years are 70, right? This is a generation, a lifespan. And if they be, and if by reason of strength, they're 80 years, fourscore means 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, tribulation. So how long? 10 years. So if you're living 10 years longer, they're going to be sorrow and pain, labor, which means tribulation. For it is soon cut off, and we fly away. That's Revelation 12. 14. When the woman flies away into the wilderness. Not the first woman in Revelation 12:6, but in 12:14, when Judah flies away into the wilderness. There's your 10.5 years. I say it's 10 and a half. I believe it's in the 10th year, which is why it says 10. I believe it's going to be 10.5. And we've got now, I've got another confirmation from Nostradamus that it's going to be 11 years or a little less. And I said about 10.5. See that? But we're not done. When the chief, okay, and it shall last 11 years or a little less, when the chief northern ruler shall fall, right, shall fall, and his southern ally shall persecute the church. Now remember, it's not the church necessarily, quote unquote, that's going to be here. But you got to remember, for Judah, for those that are still coming to Christ, that after the church, the bride is gone, the church is gone after the sixth seal, there's still people that are going to believe in Christ that are coming to Christ during this time, okay? But they're going to have to be here to endure to the end, all right? So this is what he's talking about. Shall persecute the church even more for 3 years. This is the one I tell you. This is when she flies away into the wilderness, right? He said 11 and 3 or a little less, so he's saying 11 and 3. How long is that? 14 years. He says 11 or a little less. I say it's 10.5 approximately. And this isn't 3. It's going to be 3.5 approximately. 14 years from Nostradamus. I've shown you guys the understanding of Daniel 9 based on what the Lord has revealed to me, what the Spirit's revealed working through me. And I got confirmation from what Isaac Newton said. Now I've got a confirmation from Nostradamus. Do you understand how crazy it is in my house? I'm talking about this stuff all the time. It comes all the time. I freaked out when I saw this one today. Just another confirmation. You know, last night when I was talking with my wife and my daughter, it's hard. How do I explain it to people what's happening with me? I don't know what to say. And I don't, people say, oh, this guy is talking for himself or just, no, guys, I'm in awe that I get revealed this information to share to you guys. It's incredible. I don't know how to say it. It's not about me. I'm just excited and trying to relate to you guys what kind of the understanding of what's happening. You know, those who have been following me for the last few months, they get it. You know, I hope they get it. I know some get it. But I don't know how to explain it to those who are like, listen to that guy all just talking about himself, how it's happened to him. No, guys, that's not it. It's just incredible, and I'm trying to get it across to you guys how unbelievable it is. Okay? So there we've got our 14 years. Confirmed as well now by Nostradamus. It's crazy. Well, now watch this. Remember my last video, my Joel 2, Acts 2 video, right? That one was an incredible one as well. Let's go. Well, we don't need to. Well, yeah, you know what? I probably should. Not a lot of time left, so it won't take long. Joel 2, I talked about, because when I did this study, I was trying to find out and the reason I'm going into this is it's going to lead into the last piece I wanted to share with you guys that was also new today. And that confirms more for the bride and for the churches and so forth. And when I did the video on Acts 2, Joel 2, I was trying to understand where, you know, when it says that your sons and your daughters shall prophesy and your old men and you shall dream dreams, you know, all this stuff here. I was wondering, you know, is it happening? Is it going to be during seals, right? During for the time of the churches, or is it going to be more so during the time of trumpets? And it was revealed that it's going to be during seals. All right, that you should go watch that video if you haven't. It's called something Joel 2 Acts 2. All right, and it talks about how there's two different words for the there are two different definitions of the word for the same word. Right? You have two definitions. And then it talks about, I revealed the understanding of why it had two definitions, right? That I will pour out my spirit. So the Lord says he's going to pour out his spirit. Well, if he's saying he's going to pour out his spirit, we go into Acts 2 and we see it again. And this is where Peter's talking about it. This is at Pentecost, right? Here we are at Pentecost. And he says, and it shall come to pass in the last days, right? So during, at some point in the last days, beginning of the last days, in the middle, sometime, we don't have necessarily a clear understanding of when exactly in the last days, right? But he confirms that this is what Joel the prophet was talking about. And it's true. But Peter, when he talks about it here, only used one of the words that Joel talked about when he said afterward. You know, afterward was an odd word to use there. Because what do we have here? One of the definitions in Acts 2 is the understanding of meaning last days, in the end days. Well, Peter here isn't in the end days. So what he's doing is he's not using the end days word. He's letting you know that it's going to come to pass again a pouring out of the Spirit in the last days. All right? He used one of the definitions of the word that Joel talked about for the word afterward. Right? This is where the Holy Spirit is being poured on them now. Right? One of the definitions is the pouring out of them there. That's what happened. But this one says, I will pour out of my spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is now going to be in heaven. No more over directly over the earth. Doing everything. It's the Holy Spirit that is taking the bride to heaven. All right? That's why Joel 2 said, I will pour out my spirit. Yet here in Acts 2, it says, I will pour out of my spirit. This is because the seven spirits of the churches are now going to be sent out into the earth. And again, go watch that video and you'll get the understanding of it, right? But this word here, in, it shall come to pass in the end days. Well, when in the end days? You see how the Lord, he just keeps revealing it. Wait till you see this. So it shall come to pass in the end days. So when are they going to be giving these gifts of understanding the scriptures, right? Dreams and visions and prophecies. They're going to understand scriptures. Stuff is going to be revealed to them, okay? Watch this. It came from my searching in looking up Antichrist and where the word Antichrist and so forth was found. All right? Well, watch this. We're in John, or 2 John, okay? We're in 1 John chapter 2. And, by the way, you know what? I wanted to show you something here before I forget. I thought this caught my attention here a little while ago. Listen how this starts. You got to remember, what was will be again. So we just saw here in Acts 2, this is when Peter and they have the Holy Spirit get poured out upon them. And then he says, it will come out of my spirit. This is for the one for the last days. So what took place with Peter and all of them there when the Holy Spirit came? Right? The Holy Spirit came when? When the day of Pentecost was fully come. Pentecost. Okay? When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. All right? They were all in one accord. Okay? I just thought that was really interesting because of what we're going to see. Watch. So we're in 1 John 2, and this, I didn't highlight anything here because I knew I was going to go into my favorite eSword, which everybody should download. So let's go in here. This is an awesome program. Everybody should have it. Let's go in here. First John 2. Watch what this says. Okay? So we talked about some of this stuff before, righteous, but I want to get down here a little bit further. Oh, I do want to touch on this. Watch this. Listen to what he says here. This is for, you know, people that don't know that, do we need to keep the commandments? The laws are gone. You know, if we don't do it, you know, we're under grace. Well, being under grace and being in Christ means you're going to follow and keep his laws, right? It shows through your acts for him. It shows that you belong to him for others, all right? And look it, we're in the New Testament here. Jesus is gone already, right? And hereby we do know that we know him, Jesus, if we keep his commandments. See that? You want to know if somebody is in Christ, is in the Lord, and they're with him? They should keep his commandments. See that? I'm not doing this to condemn anybody. I fall short as well. But it ties in a little bit with yesterday's video. The last video where I touched on what my brother Mark had sent me on Exodus 31, right? With the Sabbath. It's important, guys. You know, a lot of things are obviously important. All the commandments are important. But one that is so easy that people slip on and forget and just, you know, or they think it's Sunday, which it's not. They slip on the Sabbath, right? Yes, we slip on lying maybe too. We need to repent and turn back to the Lord and turn away from that stuff, right? But there you go. It's right there too. But now watch this. This is cool. Is it 18? Yeah. Okay, watch this. This is where it's talking about Antichrist and Antichrists. And when you read it, it really, I was like, what? Little children. Now, if you just have a paper Bible and you don't have a Strong's Concordance to be able to go in and reference, and you don't use a program like this, eSword, which one day will be taken away, right? As your Bibles will be taken away when the Black Horse is released. This stuff is all coming to an end. All right? If you don't have anything but a paper Bible, there's no way, you couldn't understand most of this stuff. That's why this program, this is why I promote it so much, whether you people like it or not. I know some of them, just go on to the message. But hey, this is important stuff. If you want to grow in your understanding of the Word, this program is number one, all right? Little children, if you read this without this program, you just think, oh, see, it's talking to the kids. No, it's not talking to little kids and babies, all right? It's not what it's about. Look at what it says. People say, oh, infant. Well, no, it means immature Christian, all right? That's what it's saying. It's a young, immature Christian is what it's talking about, not being a baby. Now watch this. And where does it come from? 16. Right? There it is, just like we went through in the last video. Right? Minister to the King. Well, watch this. Little children. Let's see. Little children, it is the last time. Now, what do you think that means? It doesn't just mean the last time. It means that hour, right? The time of the end is what this is talking about. The season is now. Watch this. Little children, it is the last time. So little children, it is the end days. And as you have heard, that Antichrist shall come. Hasn't come yet, all right? He's saying it is the end days. You've heard that the Antichrist will come. But he says first, even now, this is how you know you're in the end days. Even now, are there many antichrists? Where do we see that? All of it discourse, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's in there at the beginning of all of them. So remember, I try to figure out, you know, I don't have the date for you guys. We know it's going to be 40 days from a sign, and it'll be obvious, all right? Not September 23rd, but watch how this goes, all right? So this is saying little children, meaning church, right? Those of you who aren't ready yet, it's going to be in, you're in the last days, and this is how you're going to know it. You know that you've heard that the Antichrist is coming, but now, even now, there are many Antichrists whereby we know that it is the last time, the end days, the end times. So he's telling you what kicks off the end days. How will people know they're in the end times? Oh, we can go to Matthew, Mark, Luke. Let's go to Luke. Luke 21. I always thought that we go, and this is where I've been growing a lot. I thought, you know, we leave right here before nation rises against nation. But then I came to something the other day and I was like, wait a second. Be not terrified. Why would I be terrified because of hearing of wars and rumors of wars? And then it says, for these things must first come to pass. Well, remember, Luke here is talking to the bride. So what does he say? For them, this is for the bride. Luke is totally different than Matthew and Mark when it gets to this point. This is where they're talking about no one knows the day or hour. And his is, watch and take heed. Don't let anybody catch you unaware. Watch you therefore and pray always. What? That you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass. All of these things here that are going to come to pass, my group, the bride, he says, can escape them all. This says, this is first going to come to pass. So if the wars and commotions and be not terrified are what are first coming to pass, then the bride's not here for that either. Because he said to escape all of these things that come to pass. And these are the first things that come to pass. All of these are the first things that come to pass. Right? Look at this. What shall be the sign when these things shall come to pass? And Jesus said, here it is. Take heed that you be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ. See that? John, 1 John 2, tells us where the escape happens. Watch this, right? This is what he's saying. Little children, church, it is the end times, and as you have heard, that the Antichrist is going to come. He's going to show up. But even now, there are many Antichrists. That's what he was just saying in Luke. Whereby we know that it is the end days. So the church, everybody left who did not escape as the bride, when they see and hear of people saying, the Christ is here, he's over here, he's over there, he's over here, believe it not, for they are the many antichrists. And when that time comes, you're going to know that you are in the last time. You are going to know that you are in the last days. And it's exactly what Luke tells us, what Jesus tells us in Luke. They say, when shall it come to pass? Take heed that none deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ. Meaning, they are Antichrist. They are not the Antichrist, but they are Antichrist because of what they're doing and what they're saying, calling themselves Christ, all right? And the time draws near when it's all about to all start going down on you. Do not therefore go after them. But when you shall hear of wars and commotions, don't be terrified, for these things must first come to pass. So all these things must first come to pass. But yet Luke tells the bride, this is who he's talking to. He's addressing his group, the bride. They're going to escape all of these things. They're not going to be here for these first things that come to pass. They're going to escape all of it. And that's where we get to continue in 1 John 2. This is exactly where it continues. Watch this. They went out from us, but they were not of us. See that? When you understand, who is they? There's a group that went out from us. From who? From the little children. There was a group that went out from among the church, the immature Christians, the ones that weren't ready for the escape. See, there's a little group that went out when? Right before this last time, right before this end time begins, and the Antichrist starts saying this, that, and the other thing about where there's Jesus Christ, I'm Christ over here, over there. There's a group that went out from the little children, from the churches that were still here. That's the bride who was within all the churches. And it says, so they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out, that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. That sounds pretty cryptic, but it's clear as day once you understand it. This gives evidence, more evidence, that this group that goes out isn't the 144,000. Okay? Because they don't come back. Right? They went out from us. This group, there's a group that, boom, they're gone. They're no longer with us. It says, They went out from us, but they were not of us. The bride is a separate group. They're not of the church, all right? They were not of us. For if the bride had been of us, had been part of us, had been us, they would no doubt have continued with us. Meaning they would have no doubt stayed with us. But they went out, that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. Bride goes before tribulation begins, and those who remained, the church, knew, saw, understood that a group had gone out from them that were a part of them but were not of them. And they didn't come back. See? They would no doubt have continued with us, but they went out because they were not a part of us. And look, they were made manifest. Right? Appear, manifest, declare, show. Let's go to 18. Shining. Apparent, externally known, manifest, shining. Right? As the lights of the firmament. Right? To show, to lighten. Let's go to the other definition. Right? From the word. 53:16. To lighten. To shine. As in the firmament. The bride is going to be like stars. They're going to be shining bright. And maybe you're going to see us, or, you know, if I'm accounted worthy to go, you guys are accounted worthy. Like I said, hopefully none of you guys listening, guys and gals are listening, none of us are going to be here to see it. We pray that we are going to be made manifest, turned to light, and shine out of here. You get it? And then what happens next? This is where I was talking about earlier. Watch this. So for those little children who are left, right, the immature Christian, the young Christian, not meaning little children, it means the Christians who weren't ready, what happens? Joel 2, Acts 2, right? The portion that was left. Remember when it said in Acts 2, it said in, right, in the end days, right? And it shall come to pass in the last days that God shall pour out of his spirit. That's exactly what this is. Let's go back. Where'd you go? Right? That's what's being said here. That's exactly it. So they've been manifested. The bride is gone. But you, church, have an unction, an anointing. See, a special endowment of the Holy Spirit. An anointing that has been given to you. Look at this. It's even here. I didn't even notice it till just now. Of. There it is again. That little word. Of the Holy Spirit. Just like Acts 2 said. Now it is of the Holy Spirit. Through the angels, the seven spirits that have been sent out of the Holy Spirit. From the Spirit of God. And what happens? You've been given an anointing. Look, you've been given an anointing, right? We can go into that and look at that. It just means, like, who was it when they did it with, I think through Cyrus, right, through the general, right? As pouring to smear oil, right? Like that one did, he went out, raced, and went into the general and poured the oil over his head and anointed him, and then he took off running because he was feared for his life, right? And then what happened? He ran crazily. Remember, Jonathan Cahn teaches that as well. This is the anointing that comes. There's anointing that comes, which is Acts 2. You guys, the church that's left, the church that is left who wasn't ready, who wasn't part of the bride, who's going to be here during seals, will have seen the bride go and understood what happened. And then they're going to be given an anointing of Acts 2 through the Spirit. Do you see that? In three little verses here in 1 John 2. That's awesome. It's unbelievable. It says so much. Now, it doesn't give us the date of the escape, but it lets us now know when. It's before all of these things. It's before there are anybody, big names, big saying, running around saying that they're Christ. The bride is gone before that, because that is going to be the time that the end, they will know that the end began. It will be a time before the Antichrist shall come. There's going to be a group that was from the church, but they weren't of the church, because if they had been of the church and were to be part of the church, they would have no doubt continued with the church. But they went out. The bride went out and was made manifest into light, that they were not all of us. But you, church, have an anointing of those of you who were immature before. You will be given an anointing from the Holy One of the Holy Spirit. And you will begin to know all things. You will dream dreams, have visions, be filled with understanding and knowledge. Just like Acts 2 says, after Peter used one, well, I shouldn't say Peter used one, after the Holy Spirit came, he tells us the next one will come of the Spirit of God. And your daughters shall prophesy, your sons shall prophesy, your young men shall have visions, your old men shall dream dreams, and the servants and the handmaidens shall also be receiving this of the Spirit. Who is this? This is Judah. This is also the 144,000 in there. All right? That's what all this is. Isn't that incredible? I love it, man. You know, I thought this video was going to be 45 minutes. Here we go again. Good thing I didn't say anything at the beginning. All you guys would have laughed at me anyways. But guys, with that, I wanted to share it with you. You know, we touched on a couple little things, wrapped a few things up. You know, seeing this in Virgo, knowing where this is coming from, what the number 87 means, and what they call it, smoking gun. And 87 means, what was it again? About the Lord God, Right? Essentially, that's it means the Lord God. Right? Let me just bring that up again. Right? Everlasting Father. Right? The Everlasting Father is the number 87. And we are at a time right now when we are waiting, we are looking for that sign that I believe will be coming somewhere out of or from Virgo, somewhere, somehow in that vicinity. And it will be a sign to the bride and to those. Remember, nobody knows who the bride is yet. Nobody knows who's accounted worthy to be the bride until that time comes. So this is your time now. If you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ, now would be an awesome time. Because it's about to be unleashed. We're in the 70th. We're in the culmination of all of it right now. Within weeks, a couple months, before it all begins. Maybe three. That would be at the outset based on, you know, the sign being 40 days. You know, so at the furthest, 3 months out, in my belief. So now is the time. If you don't believe in Jesus Christ, watch my videos. Go through some more of this stuff. Watch some of my previous stuff. And if you are a believer and you're afraid, you're nervous, don't be afraid, but you're nervous about whether you're going to be accounted worthy to be part of the bride, here's the only thing I could tell you. I don't know, but I do know what the scriptures say. And the scriptures tell us that those who are accounted worthy pray always, right? Pray regularly, spend time with the Lord daily. They're watching, right? They're watching, that's what it says. Watch and pray always, right? So you have to believe in Jesus Christ, obviously, have given your heart to Jesus Christ, get baptized, that'd be a good thing too. Be praying, spending time with the Lord daily, be watching, whether you're watching these videos, you're watching for the signs, you're watching other people's videos, and guys, it's when you have time. The Lord knows you have work to do. There's jobs, there's bills to pay, but don't just get caught up in that stuff, right? Especially in these days, in this time, with very little time left. We don't know who the bride is, but we do know there is still time to be part of the bride, right? Because it hasn't begun yet. The 14 years haven't begun, all right? It will be obvious when it begins, all right? So there's not going to be a mystery. You will know whoever's left when it begins. Those who are the bride, they'll know, but in a different way. They're going to be, boom, suddenly standing in the third heaven before the Son of Man, before the throne. Amen. I pray to be accounted worthy for that. Oh, man. All right? So, guys, with that, I love you. God bless you. We will get into the tribulation timeline and break that down for you as well. All right? God bless. Take care.